In principle, as far as I personally am concerned, I am kind of against conferences and seminars. And in the past, under the banner of Center for Religious Studies, I have organized only workshops. We had in 2017 two international workshops. One was Tantra workshop, and then there was Rasa workshop. Professor Rajendran was here to teach us Rasa Sutra for 7 days, and it was really wonderful. He's here with us again. I would just slightly read to let the seminar begin what I have written to introduce the seminar, and then obviously we have 2 days to listen to the learned speakers. But I'm more curious, apart from listening to everyone, and I'll introduce all the speakers, to have discussions in the afternoon, which I believe all of you, I recommend also, but I believe all of you will strongly participate in the discussions in the afternoon. Those will be surrounding the topics that have been presented, or whatever questions come up during the lectures and so on and so forth. And I'll just make some few announcements after I finish the kind of concept talk. The purpose of this seminar is to ask questions that a category like Indian aesthetics may pose. What is the philosophy of art in its South Asian context, and both classical and contemporary? What do we understand by the words like beauty and awesome? This sense of wonderment is an unfading, ever rewardable sense of wonder at one does not know what, at once one does not know what it is. Since the time of Ramayana till the current milieu of post-colonial Indian literatures, films, Hindustani and Karnataka classical, as well as Bollywood movie music, and dozens of provincial dance and theatre forms of painting styles, where Picasso model miniatures and Ajanta frescoes may fuse seamlessly, very many fundamental concepts of art appreciation and aesthetic evaluation, they have changed over a period of time. I'm here also taking inspiration from this introduction by Arindam Chakravarti to this recent Bloomsbury handbook, research handbook in philosophy of art and Indian aesthetics. Yet Indian aesthetics is as vibrant with contesting constructions and reconstructions now in the 21st century as it was in the first couple of centuries of the Common Era, when the text of the Natya Shastra probably came to be canonized. There are many alternative ways of organizing Indian philosophies of art and aesthetic experience. For instance, Chapter 3 of the Vatsyayana's Kama Sutra lists 64 kalas, which includes singing, playing music instruments, dancing, etiquette, culinary arts, art of weaponry and war, gymnastics, knowing how to compose and scan verses, arithmetic, clay image making, knowing how to guess human character from conduct and gestures, cosmetics, head making, wine preparation for instance, making artificial flowers, and of course the art of painting and wall decoration. What makes it maddeningly difficult to articulate is the family resemblance sort of continuity that exists between such widely divergent forms of art as the art of lip painting and the art of war, keeping painting, sculpture, music and poetry in the central core. To encapsulate, Indian art, classical and contemporary, spreads over a vast and variegated canvas including sculpture, architecture, painting, theatre, dance, instrumental and vocal music, poetry and literature, cinema, religious rituals, crafts, public festivals, carnivals, cosmetics, perfumery, fabric design, gold jewellery, arts of primary pedagogy for teaching children of the socially marginalized how to read can be quintessentially an aesthetic agenda, sports and entertainment, urban and folk, traditional and modern. My own interest in locating the answer of these questions is in exploring the meaning of creativity vis-a-vis cognition, ritual and performance, as in meaning of creativity vis-a-vis cognition, ritual and performance. Is performance an epistemological act? And in the background of this epistemic act is there a phenomenology of what we will hear a lot the idea of cluster, for instance, that is functional. This morning, Professor C. Rajendran will tell us what Mahimavarta, the 11th century common era poetician, thinks about it. This will be followed by a lecture by Professor Torella, for whom another aesthetician in the 10th century common era, Abhinavagupta, bears an aristocratic attitude, and we are looking forward for that. I probably am not wrong in saying that Abhinavagupta understands a ritual as an aesthetic act, and also it is a cognitive act at the same time. And then examining these creative critics in reverse chronology, we finally hear Mr. Satyanarayan Hegde, who, like Mahimavarta, does not regard Anandavardhana's concept of poetic sedition simply as an inferential cognition, but a postulation, arthapatti. So not giving the importance, for instance, to Anumana idea, but obviously that's in the more epistemological context, and so we'll explain that in more detail. But this is not all what Satya has to say. While presenting another literary critic, Bhojadeva, from 11th century, he examines the asati genre in which wanton adulteresses blatantly cheat on their husbands, merely deceiving and duping them, and other guardian relatives by having illicit adulterous sex with their paramours, and further proposes as a resolution to this problematic and argue that the asati topos is in Shastra, as well as Kavya, is perpetuated and propagated by the ideology of grammatical tetrarchy. You will be questioned on that. I am sure all these ideas and questions will add a newness to our approach, the way we think and understand aesthetic creativity to be. This certainly will propel us to be rigorously prepared for our afternoon discussions, and I am really honestly hoping for that. And this should also pave a smooth way into our second day of the seminar. So tomorrow, I think Professor Torella, I expect him to begin at 9, so we will have more time for him, so I will not introduce the seminar tomorrow. So I thought it's a good idea to introduce second day of seminar also today itself. And this should pave also a smooth way into our second day of the seminar, i.e. where Professor Torella will examine Abhinavagupta on the concept of beauty using some comparative dimensions and analyzing if Abhinavagupta is a subjectivist, and what relationship does this idea share with the nourishment of spiritual refinement that qualifies one for an aesthetic experience. This also makes us further problematize the concept of aesthetics in relation to religion and psychology, where, guided by the lecture of Professor Margot Sarsasha, we explore the unique Bionian's concept of Om, which is by W.R. Bion. One must also pay attention to the Sanskrit concepts of Vismaya and Adbhuta in this context, as also the, and I quote here again, Arindam Chakravarti, intersubjectively relishable sense of amazement, what he kind of glosses the idea of chamatkar. The aesthetical and the religious sublime is best to be appreciated by studying the elusive phenomenon of awe. The experience of awe evolves and develops with time. The majority of contemporary psychoanalysts agree that the earlier form of awe, in which fear is preeminent, gives way in time to awe suffused with senses of goodness and holiness. Evolving awe becomes intertwined with the experience of the sublime in aesthetics and in religion. Awe is triggered in the context of an encounter with otherness. And the quality of distinctness or separateness seen with the heightened intensity, as if it were normal. The combination of familiarity and otherness is a cornerstone of any form of awe. This exploration into mind should also let us question the body, the performative language of which reaches its sophistication in art form called Kuya. Professor C. Rajendran's presentation, who thinks the Sanskrit theatre performances must have been grafted to the temple premises during the medieval times to ensure its sustenance, will guide us through this. I'm already intrigued. Now this is probably my already thought question to Sir. I'm already intrigued by the social role, not only of drummers, but also of the instrument of their action, the instrument called Nirauru. Questioning our contemporary aesthetic sensibilities, the resonating sound that is produced by beating the skin of an animal, is another question to ask that Gopal Guru calls, and I quote him, Dalit dialectical aesthetics of skin. So that is just to outline that what we hope to do, and I mean I didn't raise really big questions, but the engagement that we expect from all of the participants in this seminar. I will very briefly introduce the speakers. It's 9:20. They're already known scholars, but I'll just read out. So Professor C. Rajendran is joining us from University of Calicut. He was the head there for and professor there for many years. He's retired from there, but he is now the dean and visiting professor in Sri Shankaracharya University in Kalari, where he is the dean of the Sahitya department. And I have a long list of his publications. I have a long list of the places that he has lectured at. He has been visiting professor in India and abroad at many places. In my association with him, I always call him Kavya Purusha. He has guided us through many times through this very terse rasa ideas, dhani ideas. I had also the privilege of organizing with him dhani workshop for again 5-6 days in Delhi. Page Johar in IIC, which again was a text-based study, and I was really amazed that the text he has taught for the last 35 years, how in 5-6 days he just chose the points, compelling points, and he just finished the text with the Balakriya of Bhattabhiram Shastri. He did parts of that. Professor Raffaele Torella is joining us for the first time, and it's a pleasure, sir. He is currently the chair of Sapienza Università di Roma, where he has again taught for. I must say this, I have met him for the first time when I was an undergraduate student in Delhi, and since then, on and off, he has been a guide and inspiration. I try to work with Abhinav Gupta, but he's a legendary scholar who has explained to us what Abhinav Gupta means, or even his contribution has been there also in exploring the organic. Abhinav Gupta's teacher, or not direct teacher, Upalakeva, exploring him and giving him his right credit, that has been his credit also. Again, I have a long list of publications, visiting professor, he has been at many places. Professor Margot Sasha is joining us also for the first time here, and she's a associate professor of psychology of religion in the Gulbenkian University in Krakow in Poland. And I have had limited interactions with her, but I'm looking forward to have more and more interactions, particularly when after reading her abstract, and since the time I have been here in this center for the last 5 years, where I'm intrigued always as a pre-moderner by these modern questions. So whether it's in the aesthetic realm, the philosophical realm, whether it's in the complication of the idea of Indian-ness of it, or if there is anything Indian-ness, and what is it, and so on and so forth, and how do we engage with these ideas? And particularly, I think I'm looking forward to the idea of because what we very often come across and get asked about this idea whether something like aesthetic experience in rasa realm that Gupta is talking about, Bharata is talking about, or whatever the Indian side of it, what is its relationship with whatever or howsoever we define the idea of religion, religiosity, sexuality, or whatever, howsoever we name it. And then that also brings in the idea that Professor Torella is talking about the spiritual experience side of the rasa experience, that phenomenological side. How do we connect them? What does it mean? Where does that whole rubrics stand, and what we make out of it? Mr. Satyanarayan Hegde again is joining us here for the first time. when I asked, I call him Satya, his name is known. When I asked him for a bio note, so he gave me three-liner, which I must read here. Satyanarayan Hegde is an advocate practicing civil law in Mumbai that we all know him as. In Maharashtra, he has one wife, two children. He is inter alia interested in Greco-Latin, Sanskrit, Hindi, and Persian Urdu literary cultures and poetics, and occasionally perpetrates random acts of literary criticism. The simplicity of that bio-note talks, I think it is probably rather already explained in the 60-page article he has forwarded to you yesterday. And I don't know, I have no more adjectives to add. But Satya is that rare person, I must add that, who has, beyond having the great command over languages, that is to say, Latin, Greek, Persian, Arabic, Urdu, Hindi, Sanskrit, Prakrit, you see how he would quote to do Prakrit like he did. But beyond that, the criticalities he has to ask, you know, in these the literary cultures in these languages, and the kind of comparisons he brings in front of you, and by the way of those comparisons, the kind of questions that he brings in front of you, it compels you to think about a lot of new things, whatever the idea of new in. I would end this introduction only by one note that I remember from a common friend. I don't know how many of you are aware of Shamsur Rahman Farooqi Saab, who is this great, really legendary, great literary critic of Urdu poetry tradition. And he said once that in South Asia, if anybody knows Persian well, it is Satyanarayan Hegde. Now, that might be a hyperbole, but it is a hyperbole, and there is ontology to that hyperbole as well. So I hope we have a wonderful feast with all our wonderful speakers. I'm not going to read out the abstracts. I think Mikhail has made a wonderful handbook, and we have abstracts here. I think all of you have read that. Only a few things. We will try to strictly follow time. I think we are on time. The idea that, because we have this afternoon session for questions, so we have 1 hour for each speaker. As and when speaker finishes, if we have time, we will have questions, maybe one or two, maybe more. But we'll strictly stick to 60 minutes, and so that like we don't run out of time. And then, keeping in mind that if you have questions, please note them down. Please be very, keep them in your memory, because you don't want to lose them, because we will have a strong discussion. We have 2 hours for discussions. And so I think 11:30 there is tea will be served outside. One, we have lunch, but lunch again will be served outside. And after the discussion, hopefully if it reaches 5, if we finish before 5 or after 5, the tea still will be there. For very practical reasons, I think those of you who are coming from outside and don't know the building, any of you would need washroom directions. It's straight here, left, down there. So if you need those directions. Since it is an ICPR event, I'm bound by some, what I call, government rules. So please cooperate with Nikhil in, because he's supposed to take, he'll circulate, I think, the attendance sheet. So please sign, we're supposed to send that so that we get a little fun. And there is also, we are asked that we should have feedback from the participants. So I think Nikhil is planning to have some Google form, and he will send it to you. Please fill that up, whatever you want to say, so that I later can submit that to the ICPR for the legal purposes. With that note, I haven't missed anything, have I? Anything you have to ask for the very pragmatic purposes, Nikhil is there, he's looking after helping me out with everything. So with that note, I invite Professor C. Rajendran to deliver his lecture on Nema Bhatta. Thanks once again, sir, for making it he came just last night and he trained at 11 and so had some rest and now I'm submitting him again to another 1 hour long lecture. So it's...
Good morning, everybody. I'm so happy to be again here in this sleepy, beautiful town of Mumbai. Today, I'm told it's World Philosophy Day. We don't know what exactly is philosophy, but there are 13 definitions. One favorite definition which comes to my mind is asking and answering unnecessary questions. I don't know whether this is correct. But my favorite definition is, of course, asking ultimate questions about anything. And the relationship between philosophy and aesthetics is also is a bit problematic. Very die-hard philosophers do not accept aesthetics as a branch of philosophy at all. The liberal was very much unhappy about that. But you know that we have to ask questions about beauty and its enjoyment, the aesthetic enjoyment and allied questions, which readily creep up in our mind. So we have to, as human homo sapiens, we are bound to think about such aspects. And Wildeuren says that it is not confined to human beings alone. The notion of beauty is ingrained in all living beings, even in a bird which is making a nest. Like that. Anyway, this is not an occasion for me to go deeper into the other aspects of aesthetics. But I am very happy that Indian philosophy and Indian aesthetics are also find a place in any global discussion of philosophy and aesthetics. So I am very happy about that. And I feel honestly that there are a lot of Indian thinkers who have made a very wonderful contribution to our understanding of literature, our understanding of beauty, aesthetic experience, and very, very the question of language, creating language, its difference from ordinary language, scientific discourse, etc., etc., which I think are very valid in any context, any intellectual context. These few words, I would like to read out what I have written to save time. Maybe I will pause for some discussion at some point. Now, speaking about Mahima Bhatta, I'm sorry that I couldn't put the diacritical marks here, but in India we never put the diacritical marks. We follow the popular spelling, but it will be difficult to distinguish between ta and ta without the diacritical mark. Because of my sheer laziness and lack of time, I couldn't do that. Sorry for that. And he is an offbeat aesthetician. It is something very remarkable in Indian context. Because people always swear by tradition. Namulam likhyate kichit, I am bound to tradition. But Mahima Bhatta says, anyel anullikhita purvam idam bruvanam. I am saying something which has not been mentioned, said by anybody else. So it is very risky. He says that Nunam Brudel Vishela Ubeya Vidusham. So maybe I will be remembered Hasiga Karana Gaveshnaya. Maybe I may be an object of ridicule for people who don't like to violate the tradition. But I hope that there will be some, he says, some people who are interested in understanding the nature of things. So I welcome them. That is what he has said, very much like Bhavaguri. So his prophecy was proven to be correct because nobody remembers him now, except in the sense of a critical dialogue. He has been othered. That is a very strange thing which has happened in Indian history. But had he written, his work is called Vyakti Viveka. Vyakti Viveka means a discrimination of Vyakti. Vyakti is Abhivyakti. Abhivyakti is manifestation, Vyanjana or suggestion. This is the cornerstone of Anandavardhana's aesthetics. So Anandavardhana says in an action, what Anandavardhana says is a very, very great literature. The most important element of literature is not directly stated. it is revealed to your mind through a process called manifestation. This is in nutshell, another one as theory of suggestion. And Mahima Bhatta says that when we read literature, of course, the most important element about literature is never spoken directly, denoted. It is not stated. But he says that it is the intellectual capacity of the reader which comes into play. And an intelligent reader makes an inference, an anumana of the most important meaning. This is his thesis. So he says that at the outset of his work, Viveka, he says that I have written this work to show that all varieties of suggestion are, I'm going to use another word, dhoni, suggestion, they can, of mentioned by Anand Vardhana, can be subsumed under the process of inference. Anumane Andarbhava Sarvasyadi Pranete Prakashindu Vekti Vivega Gurude Mahima. This is what he has said. So at the very outset of his dialogue, he maintains that this is the sole aim. So this has been the bane and boon of Mahima Bhatta. Since he was exclusively, he fell into the trap of Anand Vardhana. He had very original ideas of many things. These were sidelined. And his work was taken up for criticism as a purva paksha, as something which has to be demolished in order to re-establish the Dhoni theory. That was the fate of Mahima Bhatta. So he is seldom read, seldom understood. And so he is more or less a sidelined institution in India. This is the fate of two great institutions in India. One is Bhattanayaka, the other is Mahima Bhatta. Bhattanayaka, I remember Dr. S. Radhakrishnan, when he speaks about Buddhism, he says that Hinduism destroyed Buddhism with a fraternal embrace. That is what Dr. Radhakrishnan said. Similarly, we can say that Abhinavgupta destroyed Bhattanayaka with a fraternal embrace. He incorporated all the major contributions of Bhattanayaka to his theory, so that nobody reads Bhattanayaka, because there is Abhinavgupta. But in the case of Mahima Bhatta, it was he is always regarded as belonging to the enemy camp. So he is a person who is to be criticized. That is how later politicians looked upon him. Even his commentator, Ruyaga is a very great learned person belonging to Kashmir. Incidentally, one of the reasons why I envy Mrunal Gaur is that he belongs to Kashmir. It is the citadel of Indian cities, all the galaxy of great authors like Anandavardhana, Abhinavgupta, Kuntaka, Mahima Bhatta, Bhattanayaka, all these people. There are only two exceptions. One is Acharya Dandi, who belong to South India, Kanchi. The other is Panditaraja Jagannatha, who belong to, again, the Telugu Desh, the Telugu region. And almost all the great institutions belong to Kaul's place, Manal's place. Okay. So, this is what I read about the date of Mahabharata. I have reached the conclusion that he wrote his Vyakti Viveka in between 1000 AD and 1050 AD. So I believe that he might have written the Vyakti Viveka which we are now discussing in 1020, exactly 1000 years ago. So this is my, I don't have any supporting evidence, but I fancy that. So we are dealing with an institution who wrote something very remarkable some 1000 years back. With these few words, let us watch Mahima Bhatta a bit closely. I will read Mahima Bhatta, who is more known as a critic of the Dhoni doctrine, deserves the attention of the student of Indian politics for his positive contributions in aesthetic theory as well. It is but natural, though unfortunate, that aspects of his poetic theory are relegated to the background in discourses concerning him, both ancient and modern, which often, even modern authors like K.C. Pandey or S.K.D. or P.V. Kane or even Dr. V. Raghavan, all these people. There is only one exception, that is Dr. Krishnamurti, who was very sympathetic to Agarwal. So, which often projects his objection to the Dhoni theory, the mainstream aesthetic thought, mostly to refute them. This unbroken tradition probably begins with Ruyaga himself, who uses the major part of his commentary of Vyakti Viveka to answer Mahima Bhatta's objections to the Dhoni theory. But a close reading of Vyakti Viveka would reveal that Mahima Bhatta has not only conceived of an all-comprehensive aesthetic and linguistic theory, but also articulate it in the course of his discussion of the defects of the Dhoni theory. So, parenthetically, or he has discussed these things. It should have been the other way around. He should have relegated Anandavardhana to a footnote or something. This is very wisely done by Kundaka. Kundaka has got his own theory of approach, and sometimes he has an occasion to discuss Anandavardhana. But he simply, you know, refers to Anandavardhana. If you are interested, you can read Anandavardhana. Why should we bother about it? That is the attitude of Kundaka. But had Mahima Bhatta followed this same procedure, then his theory, his philosophical aspects of his book might have received later, which is what I honestly feel. Of particular interest is his notion of Rasa, which Mahiman considers as the hallmark of all Kalamas. You know, Rasa is one of the key contributions of Indian aesthetics to world aesthetics. We do not have an exact, parallel to the Rasa, to the notion of Rasa in any the words like Sakhrdaya, Rasa, Chamatkar, etc., etc. They are uniquely Indian contributions to world aesthetics. You don't find exact correspondence with any concept. Sometimes we translate it as aesthetic emotion, aesthetic experience. Some people use the word sentiment, some people use the word mood, etc. Anyway, Indian, right from the time of Natya Shastra, Indian aesthetics believes that each individual is programmed with certain, propensities, certain instinctive capabilities of emotional experience. And these emotions are aroused in our day-to-day life on the basis of the stimulus which we get from the outside world. And some more psychologists of modern times believe that these emotions are survival mechanisms of human beings. For example, love is related to survival of the species. Then anger is related to escape from danger, like that, anger and fear. So that is, there is one line of thinking like that. Anyway, Indians always believe that every individual is programmed. Abhinavata beautifully puts it like this. Jata eva jantuhu yadivi sambindhi parido tauri. Even when you are born, at the moment you are born, you are surrounded by these forms of consciousness. Yadivi sambindhi. So you have what these emotions. Right from your birth, you inherit, probably from your race, you genetically, you are programmed to feel. And literature nourishes these feelings. It makes it something different. It makes these feelings as aesthetic objects, universalized, not related to any particular personality, not related to any particularity, but it is this emotion is freed from spatial and temporal considerations, and it becomes enjoyable. In literature, emotion becomes enjoyable. In real life, emotion will be always turbulent. It may be even pleasant emotions, maybe cause some sort of a turbulence. So you will never be able to enjoy your emotions, even if it is that these emotions are positive. But on the other hand, in art, what happens is there is a chemical change for these emotions. They are divested of all these turbulences, and they become enjoyable, and your mind rests in them. There is a beautiful word concept called Vishranti, coined by Abhinavutta. So our mind rests in these emotions, and we are not bothered about anything else so far as our enjoyment takes place. So Abhinavutta has got, Mahimata has got his own idea of rasa, and he says that this is the hallmark of all poetry. Poetry is to be, regardless of poetry, there should be this emotional element in it. Mahiman here gives shape to an aesthetic theory which is very similar to that of another author, another sideline author, who is called Shankuka, a commentator of Natyashastra. Shankuka, we do not know much about Shankuka, or his views are available only through citations, especially in the citations of Abhinavutta. Of course, Abhinavutta does not agree with him, so we do not know how if his views are distorted. But fortunately, we are having some verses which were originally written by Abhinavutta. We are reminded of the flight of the Charvakas. We don't have any original books written by the Charvakas, only they exist only in commentaries, especially in commentaries which are there to refute the view of Charvaka. We don't know what exactly Charvaka was saying. So the same is the case with Mahimabhatta. The same is the case. Mahimabhatta's work is available. The same is the case with Shankuka. Because in Indian tradition, we have what is Siddhanta Paksha. That is the view accepted, and you reach the Siddhanta, and all the other views are discussed to be refuted, so that as to establish the Siddhanta Paksha. So, very similar to that of Shankuka, but which is also complementary to it in several respects, in that it discusses certain issues related to poetic creation and the transcendental nature of the aesthetic experience, as well as the notion of the metaphysical dimensions of the aesthetic experience, which we do not find in the former, at least at the present state of our knowledge. This paper is an attempt to find out the characteristic features of Mahimabhatta's rasa theory in all its ramifications. Mahimabhatta maintains that there can be no poetry worth the name at all without rasa. That is, there is an aesthetic experience in the poet which is communicated in art, we can say. There is an aesthetic experience which is communicated, and without this aesthetic experience, you cannot write poetry. Even if you write or compose verses, it cannot be called literature proper. In support of this view, he repeats the arguments adduced by earlier poeticians like Kuntaka, who claim a special status for poetry in view of its pedagogical function. So the question, why art, has been asked everywhere, every time, because there are people who are not very sympathetic to art. Even now we have to justify why you should get a university funding for arts. The question people like Manan and myself will be facing. So we have to answer. There are apologies of poetry, there are defenses of poetry in the West. Similarly, in Indian tradition also, almost all the institutions have discussed why art. And they say that through, there are sciences, we use the word Shastra. I don't know whether the word science is appropriate. Probably we could use the word knowledge systems. There are knowledge systems, and there is creative literature. The difference is that the creative literature is always for enjoyment. Knowledge systems instill us with knowledge. This is called vipatti in Indian literature. Vipatti.
And with vyutpatti, you can understand life. You can, you know, manipulate your surroundings. You can do whatever meaningful things you want to do with your life. But with the literature, which is only meant for enjoyment, do you have any such important, you know, functions associated with literature is the question. Kuntaka and Mahivatta say that through literature also, you can understand life. You can become a vyutpanna. You can become a learned person. It is very important. You can become a learned person through literature also. You can understand the layout of the city of Paris by reading an novel, probably. Like that. Because a piece of literature is also negotiating with several discourses, several intellectual discourses as well. This is the view of Kuntaka. For example, if you read Rekhuvamsa, wonderful Mahakavya by Kalidasa, when you finish reading Rekhuvamsa properly, of course you will be enjoying Rekhuvamsa, but at the same time, unknowingly, you will become very proficient in a number of disciplines like principles of administration, polity, geography, then political history, and many, many other things. Of course, it is possible for you to learn polity through reading Arthashastra. But maybe you may not find it very exciting reading the text. Because the text, such texts maybe are written in a very difficult style, and many people may not like going through the drilling which is associated with these shastras. For example, if you want to learn language, you have got Pani, you have got Ashtadhyayi, you can read, you can get drilled. But there is another way, more pleasant way of mastering language. How? By reading literature, you become a master of the language. That is possible. So this is the way in which Kuntaka and Mahivatta have looked about literature. So they say that the shastras or the knowledge systems are there to instill knowledge. But through Kavya also, you will get knowledge about the world, knowledge about these knowledge systems, even though you are not aware for the time being. Because you will be so much, you know, enraptured by poetry, delighted by it. But side by side, that you know. But that is not the main aim of literature. The main aim of literature is, of course, this type of aesthetic experience. But as a byproduct of it, you will be getting this. So it is, literature is a better substitute for other knowledge systems. This is probably what professors of literature have to tell policy makers when they are asked why literature. Because we can make people better human beings, knowledgeable people, scholarly people, even without drilling, making them drilled. That is the aim of literature. That is how Indians have looked upon literature. So the very aim of poetry, according to Mahivatta, is the moral instruction in intentions and prohibitions to people like princes who, being dull-witted, cannot be instructed through scientific discourses. Or the princes of ancient India are regarded as idiots. This tradition begins with Panchatantra. You know the story of Panchatantra. The three idiotic sons of the king had to become kings in the future. So what to do? Then Vishnu Sharma says that I will teach them everything necessary. And I will be teaching them everything through parables. Within 6 months, I will make these idiots scholars. And I don't require anything from you. This is voluntary, purely voluntary. Because I have got a philosophy, I have to prove it. That is it. The same thing probably happened in the case of Alexander the Great. Because he was tutored by Aristotle. And Aristotle taught him Iliad and Odyssey. And Alexander knew, he probably misread Iliad and Odyssey, and he wanted to conquer the whole of the world. But Alexander always acknowledged the fact that his education was wonderful. Because without the Iliad and Odyssey, his education would not have been full. So this is always there. So this is very important in modern times also. If you do not want the youngsters to be made what you call machines, literature should be a part of the curriculum. Okay. Poetry pleases people through rasa and thereby renders moral instruction easy and pleasant, like a bitter medicine coated with the sugar. That is in the Western also the same analogy occurs. Guda jikshikaya, you can say. Guda jikshikaya. Guda is a sugar cotton medicine. Mahivata's concept. In Mahivata's concept, there is no substantial difference between creative literature, kavya, and scientific discourses, shastra, since the function of both alike is moral instruction. This is a very direct thing. He says, kavyasya api shastra putto upabadhita. Kavya also is a shastra, a scientific treatise. Yeah, there is no doubt about that. Only the mode of instruction differs in between them. But in poetry and drama, the instruction becomes possible only through rasa. And hence, for the very fulfillment of its aim, poetry requires rasa. So rasa, we cannot dispense with rasa. Without rasa, poetry cannot be pleasing. So that is prerequisite. This position of Mahivata is an improvement even from Anandavardhana, the staunchest water of rasa dhoni, who even when conceding that a composition devoid of rasa is a misspelt word from the poet. Anandavardhana says, so apashabdo mahan kaveh, nirasastu prabandho yaha, so apashabdo mahan kaveh. So a composition devoid of rasa is a misspelt word, apashabda. This is what Anandavardhana says. But even he has to accommodate poetry without rasa. There is Chitra Kavya, for example, that he has to accommodate. He says that, what to do? I don't like Chitra Kavya, but this there has been an unbroken practice of even well-known poets to compose without any emotional involvement. So I have to accommodate. Therefore, but keeping in view of this, nevertheless, Anandavardhana concedes the theoretical possibility of pictorial poetry, Chitra Kavya, in deference to the practice of poets to compose poems without any aesthetic emotion at all. Keeping in view of his stubborn insistence on the necessity of rasa, Mahivata even defines poetry as the function of the poet consisting of the coordination of vibhava, the invariably relating to the manifestation of rasa. Kavivyabharohi vibhavadi samyojanatma rasa abhivyakti adhivyari kavyam uchya. Yes. So always it is related to rasa. Anubhava vibhavana varnana kavyam uchya. Another definition. It is a description of vibhavas and anubhavas which constitutes poetry. Now, in Mahimavata's concept, it is that rasa which is sought to be communicated by the poet through the poem or the play. But here, like any other aesthetic theoretician, he has to confront a number of difficulties. The main problem hinges on the reality of the aesthetic experience. So, what do you call, is the aesthetic experience an illusion or is it a real experience? This is a very important question which he asks. Here, Mahimavata makes a demarcation between real life and art and maintains that the technical terminology used in aesthetic discourses consisting of terms like rasa, vibhava, anubhava, and vibhijari bhava. I hope that you are conversant with these terms, because it will take another hour for me to deal with these things. Anyway, these are for the students of English. These are objective correlatives, okay, of the concerned aesthetic state if you make use of TSE unit. Also the vibhavas, the vibhavas are the stimulus, the anubhavas are the psychophysical manifestations of the emotions. The vibhyari bhavas are the transitory mental states which are going to accompany the rasa. And these are all technical terms used by Bharata in the Natya Shastra. And technical terms can never be used in real life. Okay, you will never ask for sodium chloride. You are asked for table salt. Okay, so technical terms are used only in the domain of the concerned knowledge system. So Bharata uses the word vibhava, anubhava, vijayanubhava, etc., etc. These are all jargons. They can be used only in dramaturgy. And why he has used these terms? He could have used common words which we use in our ordinary discourses. He also says, it is exactly to bracket of the aesthetic realm from real life that Bharata has made use of this. These are relevant only in discussions about aesthetics, not in real life. Are relevant only in the imaginary world of life. In the real world, to God, there are no vibhavas and the like. There are only causes of the emotions and the like instincts. Nachi loke vibhava deha bhava apva sambhavanti khetvadi nameva tatra sambhava. This is what he says. In real life, we don't have this. The actual causes and effects and concomitant emotions of real emotions in life are different from their artistic representations in the imaginary world, which are known through the technical terms like vibhava, anubhava, and vibhyari bhava. Mahima concedes that real emotions inferred from real causes and the like in life do not give rise to any aesthetic delight at all. That is, when you look at a person who is crying miserably, you are an intelligent person and you can understand that he has got some sorrow. It's an intelligent guess. So we can guess, looking at people, you can understand what is the emotion which is going on in their mind. But when you do that, you do not derive any sort of aesthetic pleasure. In that case, it would have been wonderful if you simply infer the emotions of other people and you get emotional experience. Then there is no necessity for any artistic representation. There is no necessity for literature at all. But unfortunately, in our real life, we make intelligent guesses, but they do not create any sort of aesthetic experience. When people infer emotions like sorrow from their external symptoms, there is not even an iota of pleasure to the person who makes such inference, unless he is a sadist. So if you feel that he is suffering like anything, some people may feel they are perverts, but in the case of ordinary human beings, you don't get any sort of pleasure out of that. On the other hand, it gives rise to unparalleled pain like fear, sorrow, and ill feeling to normal and indifferent people. Like if you go to a palliative care unit, you can see people suffering. You will never feel happy about that. If there is no rasa, there is only what you call a poignant feeling of sorrow or other allied emotions. Hence, an institution has to confront the question as to why vibhavadi alone gives rise to a pleasurable experience, not their real counterparts in life. This is a big question. In the West, it has been asked as the problem of tragedy, tragic pleasure. But we know that all these things are very painful. Some emotions are very, very painful. But we read tragedies again and again. We go to even, A.C. Bradley said that the suffering of Desdemona is unbearable. But again and again, we go to the theatre to see the performance of Othello. Why? There is some transformation undergoing there. So that may be the reason. The question is asked in Indian tradition by, not only by Abhinavutta, but Mahimata also asks the question and answers in his own way. Mahimata tries to answer the question on the basis of what can be called, described as philosophical naturalism. swabhavavada. He says it is the swabhava of things. Even question the swabhava. Why sugar is sweet? You don't have any answer for that. So, it is the nature of things, vastu swabhava, that aesthetic experience takes place in the arena of art and through artistic representation of emotions. The vibhavadi differ from their counterparts in real life, in nature. In nature, swarupa and range, there is a difference. In the case of vibhavadi and the process, etc., there is a difference in swarupa and vishaya. So, they are unreal, while the latter are real, in the case of swarupa. In the case of vishaya, they exist in the realm of art and the latter in real life. Hence, the difference in nature and range. Mahavatta maintains that the basic mental states, sthayi bhavas, are long-lasting. Stayama ajava. They are always there. These basic mental states are always there. That is why they are called sthayi bhavas. This is also mentioned by Abhinav Gupta. Abhinav Gupta says that all the transitory mental states, like lajja, like despondency, like thoughtfulness, these come and go. But your basic emotions like love, you know, they are always enduring emotions in yourself. Until the moment of our death, these will be there. And Abhinav Gupta gives you a politically incorrect example. He says that Nahi Chaitraha Egasyam Striyam Rakta Iti Anyasu Virakta. Simply because Chaitra is in love with one woman does not mean that he is out of love with other women. I don't agree with the content, but what he wants to make out is that these emotions are enduring. You are angry with something, and that does not mean that all your anger is exhausted with this single incident. In future also you may become angry like that. Mahavatta, they are long-standing states which originally exist in the actual persons like Rama, but which are internalized, atmani anusamkhidaha, by the poets. That is a process of, how do you write a novel? There is a process of internalization. There is a projection on one hand. You imagine the characters and you internalize them so that you feel their emotions. So even all the characters who have been portrayed by Shakespeare are parts of his psyche, actually. They are part of his being, part of his personality. Even Iago or somebody else, there are parts of Shakespeare's of being. Otherwise, he cannot write. That is the difference between the same character being depicted in different manner by different people. Because an element of your personality creeps up in the distinction. So he says that these are atmani anusamphidata, anusamthana. They are internalized, imaginatively internalized by the author himself, by the poets for the sake of artistic description. Their function, see, there are very beautiful description of the art of writing in ancient India. For example, Valmiki writing the entire Ramayana. So you have to be omniscient about the Ramayana. You have to be conversant with everything which have happened still with the beginning of the story until its end. So Indians use the word kara badara samana, like an apple or which you hold on your palm. You can manipulate that, you can look at it from different angles. Similarly, you look at it from a holistic point of view, from different standpoints, and so you will be totally, you know, conversing with what you are going to say. That is how you have to write. Their function, so they are internalized. Their function in art is to cause the experience of the concerned lesser. In other words, they cease to be real emotions the moment they are internalized by the poet, and thereafter their function is only communicating. The same is the case with the bhavas, anubhavas and vivijari bhavas, which all become instruments for aesthetic communication for the poet. Thus the vibhavadi are substantially different from real causes, and like the and the like, and aesthetic experience is possible only through from the former. Mahimota asserts that the emotions like love, which are inferred by the reader or the spectator from poetry or performance of play, are unreal. They are not real. However, this consideration of reality and unreality does not affect the function of art in the least. There is a big question. How is a performance convincing? Or epistemologically, how can a performance, we know that it is only a performance, but still we have what sort of an emotional involvement. How is it possible? In West, there is a question, there is a notion of suspension of disbelief, something like that. But Abhinavuta, Mahimata has got this on very interesting observations about it. An important point made by Mahimata is that being experienced pradhiri mantra sara is a hallmark of aesthetic experience. Aesthetic experience, what is its function? Its only function is to be being experienced. It is therefore only experience. And it does not have any other ontological value apart from being experienced. The moment it is experienced, it ceases to exist. And not the ontological existence. He says, thus, when the difference in nature and range between the vibhavadi and causes, etc., has been established on the basis of their respective artificiality and reality, as well as their respective belonging to the world of poetry and world of actuality, their identity is also rejected. Therefore, when there occurs a cognition of the unreal emotions like love, they can be designated as being cognized, pradiyamana, or being inferred, gamya. The enjoyment of rasa in its natural form relates to this cognition. That is, when this love or anger, these things are cognized, they are called rasa. They are cognized through art, they are called through vibhavadi, they are called rasa. When they are cognized through real things which you can pinpoint in the outside world, they are not rasas, they are only emotions, they are not enjoyed. That is how he looks upon it. This view assumes the aesthetic emotion is an object of direct experience. Mahimota seems to concede that there may be some philosophical difficulties in maintaining that an inner mental state like love being inferred through poetry is an object of direct experience, since direct experience is a process of perception and not inference. The Buddhists are very, Mahimota follows Buddhistic logic in many respects. The Buddhists speak about two aspects of reality. One is Swalakshana and the other is Samanilakshana. Swalakshana is the bare real thing which is revealed to us through perception. Samanilakshana is an abstraction which we get through. For example, I see a car here, that is Swalakshana. But I understand that a car has come through its own. That is an abstract concept of car. That is called Samanya Lakshana. I do not know which car it is. It is nevertheless a car. So this distinction is there. So when you infer something, you get only a generic idea, an abstract idea of the thing, and you don't have that direct feeling. So that is a big problem which has to be answered by Abhinavuta, solved by Abhinavuta. Here he adduces an old principle of aesthetic charm. Objects become more charming the more they are removed from direct perception. That's what he said. When hidden things become, when beauty is hidden, it becomes more charming. When an emotion is hidden, it becomes more charming. The more indirect is the mode of communication, the more is the entering charm. When you speak out something, the charm is lost. But when it is revealed indirectly, then there are some object, there are some sort of obstructions, and they are removed, and gradually beauty is revealed. Then it becomes all the more very, very beautiful. You know, almost all the artistic forms of India, there is the Yavanika. People thought that Yavaniga came from Greek, the Greek theatre, but unfortunately the Greek theatre does not have any cartoon at all. So Yavaniga was an Indian invention. Probably the Yavana girls might have been the people who had held it in the first instance. Anyway, what is the philosophy of Yavaniga? in a Kathak, for example, Kathakali, you know, your expectations are aroused. Everything is concealed from you. Gradually, you get at that reality. So that is a philosophy. That is the philosophy of Dhani also. A real object directly perceived does not give us the charm which it would provide if presented through the words of an accomplished poet. And an object presented through poetry, if left unexpressed and let to be inferred by the reader, becomes more charming than directly expressed. The more indirect the presentation, the greater the aesthetic appeal. Mahimota quotes two important verses here in support of his position, which unfortunately, without revealing his source. The first verse could be translated thus. Emotions are not that much charming when directly experienced as they are experienced through imaginative identification when presented through the skills of poetry. Another verse, the emotion inferred through causes, effects, etc. is not as charming as the emotion which is inferred through vibhavadi. The expressed meaning does not please as much as the suggested meaning. So, if somebody asks, are you unwell? It is not that I am not unwell, something like that, it becomes more charming. The example given by him is that if you have got double negatives, the positive becomes more charming than directly stating it. Of course, it is well known that this is a fundamental postulate of the Dhani theory itself, criticized by Mahimota. Mahimota is in full unison with Anandavardhana in this regard, and his objection centers around the technical problem whether the suggestion meaning is inferred or suggestion. Mahimota does not have any aesthetic dispute with Anandavardhana. He fully agrees with Anandavardhana. But in the Prakriya region, he has got his own philosophical position, the technical aspects of the Dhani theory. Mahimota quotes the following passage from the Dhanyaloka in support of his position. Sarvabhya, the quintessential sense, revealed through being without being expressed by words, directly expressing it causes excessive charm. Then, it is in this context that Mahimota makes an important statement in the ontological, about the ontological stature of poetry. He maintains that poetry and the like have their essence in how they are experienced. It does not matter if the world presented by poetry is a make-believe world devoid of reality, so long as the poem results in an experience. It is the experience which counts and not its essence. Mahimota here avers that people to whom poetry addresses itself are those who are to be shown the correct path in life, and they acquire erudition in their duties of life, the intentions and prohibitions through the experience of rasa. In this context, Mahiman adduces two interesting dicta in support of his position, one from an anonymous source and the other from Dharmakirti's Pramana Vartika. The first quotation runs like this: even illusory knowledge is a form of valid knowledge through indirect connection. Brandirani sambandha prama. That is, we hit upon profound truths through our silly mistakes. Sometimes that happens. Even in great inventions have been like that. You search for something, you get something else. Like that. So that is the meaning of it. The second one, Mani Pradiva Prabhayoho, Mani Buddhya Abhidavadoho, Mithya Jnana Avisheshi Vishesho Artha Kriya Prati. Here, what is that meaning? Between two persons who march towards the luster of a jewel and a lamp, mistaking them for an actual jewel, though there is no difference in the falsity of knowledge, there is difference in its causal efficiency. That is, just imagine that two people have an illusion. One person believes that there is a jewel, the other person also believes that there is a jewel. In the case of the first person, it is the reflected light of a lamp which causes the illusion. In the case of the second person, it is the reflected rays of the jewel, actual jewel, that causes the illusion. And both of them proceed towards the illusion. And the person who mistakes the jewel, the lamp for the jewel, he does not get anything. The person who is carried away by the mistake of the race of the jewel, for the actual jewel, he is having an illusion, but ultimately that illusion yields him the jewel. So what happens is that in poetry you have got an illusion. The emotional experience is an illusion. That does not mean that poetry is worthless, because already you get all that you want through poetry. Only through that sedation or through that experience, you are hypnotized in that state, and you get all that you want to know about life through poetry. This is like a magic. This verse occurs in Abhinava Bharati text also, while referring to the view of Sri Sangha with regard to the interpretation of the Rasa Sutra. Shankuva also, like Mahivata, was another advocate of the theory of inference, though nowhere in the Vyakti Vivega the writer makes an explicit reference to him. From this, one would hazard the suggestion that both Shankuva and Mahivata were somewhat influenced by the philosophy of Acharya Dharmakirti in their formulation of the Rasa experience. We can assume that the concept of Rasa appearing in Shankuka and Mahivata bears a striking resemblance with the notion of illusion seen in the philosophy of Dharmakirti. Reviewing the concept of the knowledge in later Buddhist schools, Hirena shows that if for the Madhyamikas both perception and inference are of provisional value, inference is even more so for all the other schools as well, the Sautrantikas, the Vaibhashikas, and the Yogacharas alike. Because according to the Buddhist doctrine, relations are all false, and inference, which is based on a supposed relation between two terms, cannot therefore be valid. The Buddhists are very skeptic. They have got what you call epistemological skepticism about this world, because the world is in a flux. Even if you are supposed to know the world, by the time you know the world, it has changed. It is like looking at a distant star. By the time the light rays reach your eyes, the star has changed. Probably the star has altogether disappeared. So that happens in the case of our knowledge of the external world. There's no guarantee about that. We have got only some impressions. And this is not the case with the inference also. When we infer things, the relations themselves, there is a question of universals. They got to accept the universe. There cannot be an enduring thing called the universal, because everything is in a flux. So there is a lot of problem about inference. But still, these are useful in our life. Without them, just like as Shankara argues, in the Vyavaharika sphere of things, we have to accept these things. The Buddhas also seem to think about like that. Moreover, inference always has a reference to the ideal mental constructs, samanya lakshana, the essence of things in themselves. So lakshana being experienced only in direct perception. Dingdaga even maintains that the whole process of inference refers to what is imposed by thought and has no relation to external reality. Thus, knowledge in Buddhistic philosophy occupies a very precarious position. In the words of Kiriyana, knowledge may have value for life, but its metaphysical significance is next to nothing. The criterion for truth, hence, is not absolute conformity with reality, but a utilitarian test. So how do you know that something is real? By testing its utilitarian aspect, whether this is useful for your practical requirements. Accordingly, a knowledge which fulfills the practical expectation it raises is deemed to be true. To quote Hirena, knowledge merely lights up, as it were, the path of action. And so long as it successfully does so, it is regarded as true. That knowledge helps us in the path of action. Knowledge helps us to act. We are not bothered about the philosophical question, whether knowledge is in the ultimate sense real or not. But it is helpful for us practically. It has got only a provisional value. The analogy is given. So here of a person who sees only the luster of a shining jewel, but mistaking it for the jewel itself, stretches forth his hand and happens to secure it. So this knowledge, or in our real life, this knowledge, we need not bother about the philosophical, ultimate philosophical validity of knowledge, because that knowledge may fail in that test, but it is practically useful. It is very significant that Mahivatta, who argues that the cognition of rasa is a case of inference, using the terminology of Buddhistic logic, uses the same analogy in support of his argument that whatever may be the ontological status of the characters in poetry and drama, what matters is the cognition of rasa as existing in them. Whether Rama or Krishna are historical persons is a question to be asked by historians. Whether Valmiki Ramayana is a historical document is a question to be asked by a concerned historian. And for a person who is concerned with literature, what matters is the experience. When experience is communicated, everything is fulfilled through that experience. The rasa is a guarantee for the successful function of art, in that it can attract people and instruct them through entertainment. When Mahivatta maintains that the essence of art lies in the impression it creates, is actually relinquishing any exclusive claim of its inherent validity as a form of knowledge. So Bharata also in his Natyashastra speaks about what you call all the things, like the crown you want worn by the king may not be the actual crown, because the actual crown will be very heavy, and the sword which is wielded by the hero may not be an actual sword, it's a replica. It is only made of some lighter material, because it is a make-believe system. It is only a make-believe system. All the things which are shown in a magic, for example, they are not real things. They create an impression, they create an illusion. So Vaivana says all these things are there to create the illusion. They need not be the real replicas from the real life. Okay. But it is interesting to note that both Anandavardhana and Mahivatta, his arch rival, are in full unison with each other in forestalling any attempt to apply any validating tool to the facts presented in poetry, facts within poetry. Anandavardhana says, as a matter of fact, the question of logical truth and falsity in regard to suggested meaning is entirely futile. Such being the case, it would be ridiculous if one were to indulge in discussions regarding different instruments of knowledge applicable therein. Okay, Mahivatta echoes the same sentiment. This is a lesson which we have forgotten. We look upon epics and other things. Primarily, we should have looked upon epics and literary pieces as literature. We look upon them as anything but literature, as historical documents which are having historical validity. That is not the way they were intended to be looked upon in Indian tradition. Mahivatta echoes the same sentiment. Hence, a consideration of truth and falsity of the probands and probandum is of no use for the ideal connoisseurs. In the arena of poetry, the consideration of truth and falsity of the cognition of the expressive and suggested sense is of no use at all, and hence the verification through other means of knowledge becomes a matter of ridicule. How far does Mahivatta agree with Sri Shankuka, who also subscribed to the similar inference theory with regard to the interpretation of the Rasa Sutra? The answer is difficult to find, since we find several gaps in the theory of Shankuka as reproduced in the Abhinava Bharati. And since Mahivatta is mysteriously silent about his in-depth analysis to him, Shankuka is famous for his analogy of the picture of the horse, Chitra Duragan Nyaya, by means of which he seeks to explain the relationship between the actor and the character imitated by him. So Shankuka is very famous with his analogy, the picture of a horse and the actual horse. All of us know that the picture is not the real horse, but at the same time, we take, for our practical purposes, we take the picture to represent the horse. the same thing happens in the theater also. The actor, we know that the actor is not the real character. We know that he is only an actor. We don't need to overall time, space, frame. And the character belongs to historical or mythological time. We know that. But for the time being, we assume that the character is, the actor is the character himself through the analogy of Chitra Thiraka, the horse and its picture. So this is a very important contribution made by Shankuka in his aesthetic theory. And but Mahimota does not refer to this analogy anywhere in his Vivega. Abhinavatan in his Abhinavardi reproduces the criticism made by Bhattadauda on the imitation theory of Shankuka. Shankuka believes in the imitation. The poetry is an imitation of, or the art is an imitation of life. Somewhat different from what Aristotle has said. Though Aristotle also uses mimesis, there is a lot of difference in the concept of imitation. But Abhinavata staunchly refutes the imitation theory. Abhinavata says that there is no imitation of life in art. If it were imitation, imitation is simply mimicry, and mimicry will give you only, will be abusive. And so, we cannot say that art is an imitation of life. Art is a representation. It is a semiotic, inter-semiotic representation of life. You are entering into a sign language, and with your signs, these signs may be words or gesticulations or musical notes or colors or lines or whatever. You are representing something from life. That's all. The whole inference theory of Mahimota has been subjected to a thorough scrutiny by Vivega in his gloss on Vyakti Vivega. Vivega, a staunch advocate of the Dvani theory and the concept of Abhivyakti with regard to rasa realization, obviously under the influence of Abhinavata, raises certain fundamental issues. First of all, he makes it clear that the question of rasa is to be examined from the standpoint of the connoisseur. There, since it is the connoisseur who is the enjoyer, charvayita, and since enjoyment constitutes the essence of rasa. Vivega rejects the view that rasa exists in the imitated person or the imitator. Rasa does not exist in the character, rasa does not exist in the actor. Actually, rasa is cognized in the generalized form, sadharanikrita, of cognition, in which individualistic features like space, time, state of being, and the like are removed. Vivega conceives that since original characters like Rama and the actors impersonating them are also involved, rasa can only be described in terms of them also. However, it is not proper to restrict the rasa exclusively to the character and the actor. Since sage Bharata's dictum that the basic mental state becomes the rasa is an authoritative statement. Sthayi bhava rasa ibanesya. So it is connected with the sthayi bhava or the basic mental state. So Vivega represents the rasa theory of the Dvani theorists like this. It is the basic mental state of the connoisseur, the reader, the spectator, your emotion, that it becomes the rasa. Not that of the character, not that of the actor. It is your emotion which becomes the risk. And Mahimavata is silent about that. Vivega presents a rasa, there can be no aesthetic enjoyment for people without sensibility. Aesthetic, there is some sort of a sensitiveness which is necessary. Some sahradayatva or something like that. You should have the same wavelength as that of the art. Then only you will be able to enjoy. That means in the aesthetic experience, your own psyche is involved. If you are not having the propensity to enjoy rasa, poetry will not be able to do anything for you. Yeah, there can be no aesthetic enjoyment for people without sensibility. That sense can conclude that it is the actual instinct of emotions like love within the connoisseur which develop into the state of rasa. Importantly, Vivega rejects the contention of Mahimavata that the basic mental states like love and the Vibhavadi call so because they are comprehended in a universal manner and which arouse the state are unreal. So Vivekananda says that aesthetic experience is very real because it is your emotion and you experience that emotion. You cannot say that it is an illusion. You are convinced that they are very much real as they can be Vibhavadi only when organizer as real. In direct contradiction to Madhyamavata's position, Vivekananda points out that if they are cognized as unreal, they would only be causes, effects and the like and not vibhavas and bhavas and the like. So what Vivekananda says is that in the stage presentation, we are given the vibhavas etc. and we cognize them not as unreal but as real. Not as real causes etc. but as real vibhavadi etc. Vivekananda points out that, in fact, it is precisely to bring this idea that Bharata has used the terms like Vibhava, Anubhava and Vivyari Bhava, which is suggested transcendent, logottara nature. So, Bharata has used these words purposefully because they are different from the real world and they are having a transcendental existence. And in that existence, they are really real. In short, it is the actual vidyamana, an instinctive vasana atma, basic mental state like love, which is manifested yatra without obstacles, vignas, like the memory of the invaluable relationship in the Bhava. So what is rasa? Rasa is simply your own emotion being an experience by you, which this experience is triggered off by a performance in the theater or by your reading the poetry. At that time, your mind, you know, comprehends the Vibhava, Anubhava and Vidyanubhava. They are real, they are organized as real, they are not illusions as mentioned by Mahimata. So what is the difference between Mahimata and one hand, Rivela and others on the other hand? According to Mahimata, the aesthetic performance or the literature is something like a magic. It conjures up some sort of a phantom of reality. It is not, it has got only a semblance of reality and the experience is real, the experience is illusion, but that illusion is having its own validity because it helps us. That illusion is very much similar to the illusion which is portrayed by the Buddhists in their theory of knowledge. But that illusion is not a worthless illusion, that is useful. Because all illusions may be sometimes helpful in what real. So in poetry, you get an illusion, but that illusion is a value-charged illusion, according to Mahimata. Vivekananda also raises certain pertinent objections to the analogy of jewel and lamp, Manipradeepa Nyaya, especially when Mahimata argues that the cognizant emotional love, etc., is also unreal. It is proper to say that when an unreal thing gives rise to the cognition of a real thing, there can be inference. But how is it possible to infer an unreal object from an unreal object? That is the question. The question of this Madhyapradeva Nyaya is that ultimately you get the jewel. But ultimately, does the connoisseur get the real emotion? No. So that analogy is false analogy. So the analogy is not because Mahimata rules out the possibility of reaching out the reality, very much like Derrida does, isn't it? You are within the plane. Okay, you cannot go out of it. So, you cannot outreach reality. So, but according to Vivekananda, what happens is that there is real emotion. Our own experience is real. When you read poetry, you have very real experience. So this analogy will be proper. Vivekananda contends that the criterion of causal efficacy, arthakriya, is fulfilled only according to the view that rasa is manifested, since here the rasa actualized is real. So in actual art, the rasa is very much real. It is not an illusion. To sum up the whole issue, it seems that Indian aesthetics has two diametrically opposite concepts with regard to the key term rasa. While earlier commentators of Bharata, like Lollada and Shankuga, and probably Bharata himself, looked upon the rasa from an empirical standpoint and articulated the notion with regard to the character of the play and the actor impersonating the character, we find a paradigm shift in Pattanayaka and Abhinavagupta, who were concerned with the reader and the spectator. So Bharata was actually, for whom is Natyashastra meant? It is an acting manual. It is meant for actors. It is meant for stage managers and not for the ideal reader. So what happens, Bharata speaks about rasa, he speaks of vibhava, etc., etc., in terms of the actor and the character. So these are all helpful tips for the actor, how to present a play, perform a play. And later what happens, when Pattanayaka and Abhinavagupta enter the scene, they look upon the aesthetic experience from the point of the reader. What the play does to the reader? There is an experience. How do you understand this experience? Is it real? How, if it is real, how is it different from ordinary types of experiences? So this is what happens. And in between, Mahimavata is brought in between these two rival camps. And so what happens is that he has to pay the price for that. It is inevitable that any notion of rasa centered on the character who is fictitious and the actor who is creating a make-believe world has to be essentially based on the standpoint that rasa is only an illusion. On the other hand, if one is to concentrate on the reader or the spectator, one cannot escape the notion that the rasa experience is very much real. As Bharata puts it, the whole body of the spectator, it seems, is infused with it, like dried wood by fire. So very wonderful passage in Bharata's Natyashastra. Yortho hrudaya samvadi tasya bhavo rasodham shariram vyapyate tena shushkam kashtam ivartina. So the rasa catches up. Like fire catching dry wood, rasa catches our body and our whole body is infused with rasa. That happens in the case of the reader. So Bharata sometimes casts a glance on the reader also, though his work is primarily focused on the actor and the character. In other words, the rasa existing in a character like Rama or an actor who impersonating him is anything but real, but rasa experienced by the reader or the spectator is indeed very real. All these issues find frequent references in the learned discussions of Abhinavagupta, the author of those all available coming to Natyashastra. Abhinavagupta is emphatic on his notion that rasa is nothing but the innate and dormant sthayi bhava existing in the sahodaya, being aroused by the poetic presentation or performance. However, we find that Anandavardhana, the proponent of the Dhani doctrine, of which Abhinavagupta is the most able defender, silent about the whole issue of the cognition of rasa. Anandavardhana, nowhere in his Dvayaloga, discusses the question whether the rasa exists in the reader or the character. Hence, it is difficult to ascertain if he believed that the rasa is an illusion or real experience, though it can be argued that all subsequent elaborations found in Abhinavagupta are germinally found in his own book and Lojana. To be fair to Mahimavata, he is not expected to be familiar with the philosophical elaborations and the transcendental explanation given to the rasa by Abhinavagupta. Abhinavagupta Kabilavadi was written after Mahimavata's Yakti Vyaga was written. And Abhinavagupta had Lojana before him, but he had scant respect for Abhinavagupta. Mahimavata is probably the only one in the whole arena of Sanskrit poetics who, you know, is not at all impressed by Abhinavagupta. About Abhinavagupta, he uses the word Pandita Vidyunmanina. Some people who parade themselves as scholars. This is the comment of Mahima Bhatta on Akhinagutra. Probably they were rivals, they were contemporaries, and we find some sort of a rivalry in their dialogue. So he is not at all impressed by what Abhidhavata has written, already, and he is not expected to know what he would have written in a subsequent book. That may be the reason why Mahivata does not speak about the positions of Abhinavata. Only in one very technical context he mentions Abhinavata. It is not, however, fully correct to maintain that Mahivata is totally unaware of the transcendental explanation given to the rasa realization. He quotes two very interesting verses. From an anonymous source which deserve to be quoted here in view of the transcendental nature of rasa described in the Masan and Patwardhan translate this verse as thus. Thus when, from the recitation and the singing of the Dhruva songs, rasa reaches its peak, that is, the spectator is filled with the rasa, he turns his attention inwards, andarmukha, for a moment, concentrated entirely on enjoying that profusion, bhara of rasa, and becomes delighted. At that moment, tataha, when he is immersed in his own nature, swarupa, and he is unaware of any outside object, nirvishaya, his own deep flow, nishyanda of joy becomes manifest, by which even yogins are pleased. These are the two verses quoted by Mahibhavata, which, you know, give you a very transcendental picture of the rasa experience. The tune and tenor of the reference in Yajna Vega suggests that Mahibhavata very much subscribes to this view as per which rasa becomes a transcendental concept defying analysis. However, we do not find in him any conceptual attempt to formulate a transcendental rasa theory with inference as a key process. One cannot escape the feeling that in this paradigmatic shift in Indian aesthetics ushered in by Patanayaka and Abhinavata from an earlier empirical conceptual rasa confined to the specificity of space and time of the actor and the character to a transcendental one going beyond a spatial and temporal distinction. The varying attempt of Mahimavata to rejuvenate the whole theory of inference was bound to fail. That is a problem. That is when you come after Einstein and you want to improve on Newton, you have a problem. The same thing happened in Indian history. Because earlier theorists like Lollana and Shankuga had formulated their own aesthetic concept purely on the basis of empiricism. But later on, with Patanayaka and increasingly later on by Abhinavata, what happens? There was a sea change in Indian aesthetic scenario, and rasa, all these concepts of vibhava, etc., become transcendental. They have got this adida svabhava, and they go beyond individuality, and you have a timeless, you know, spaceless experience where your self is forgotten, which is very similar to spiritual bliss. It is Patanayaka for the first time who speaks about aesthetic experience as very similar to spiritual bliss. It is called Brahmananda Sabrahmachari. It is very similar to the spiritual bliss, the spiritual experience. But only thing is that in spiritual experience, you do not come back to real life. But in aesthetic experience, it is contingental. It is based on certain conditions. And when these conditions disappear, you come back to real life. So you have got a taste of spirituality when you enjoy literature. And it lasts so far as your engagement with art lasts, and when you come back to real life, this is lost. This is the notion of Patanayaka and Abhinavata. And Patanayaka says that this experience from art is superior to spiritual experience. because it's spiritual experience, you have to go through all sorts of very severe, you know, meditation practices, yoga, hatha yoga, etc. But here, everyone can have access to literature. But Abhinavaka says that this is only a tiny drop of water in the vast ocean of bliss. That is the ultimate spiritual experience. So there is some sort of difference between these two. And when Mahimavata was writing, he was aware of some development taking place, but he didn't think it necessary to develop such a transcendental theory. That is why we find some sort of a imperfection, some sort of a picture which is not complete, that we find in his theory. And he has followed Buddhistic cognitive theory in the formulation of his aesthetic philosophy. Thank you very much for question.
Thank you very much once again, sir.
Did you get
No, yes. I think it was no, no, but it was worth it. And you coming here and talking on Mahimavata, which I remember was also your PhD topic, and since then you have been working on. And to listen to you on Mahimavata, I have no right, and that's to stop you. There is no way.